Today we are welcoming Mike Andrews, who received his MFA from Cranbrook Academy of Art, where I also received my MFA. So he's kind of buddies with me in that way. And he got his BFA from the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, where he is now assistant professor in the Fiber and Materials Studies Department. He also serves as the director of the Oxbow School of Art in Saugatuck, which we had a presentation about last week. He runs their programming. His work consists of large life-size weavings, installations, and performances tackling gender, identity, craft, and the digital versus tactile, merging many mediums and discourses, including sculpture, fiber, and painting. He has had exhibitions in Artist Space at the MCA, Objects Art Space, Miami, Revolution Gallery in Ferndale, Michigan, Ross Art Museum, a lot more, and he has an upcoming solo show at Volume Gallery this June. I am very excited for him to share his work and his process and kind of what it means to be for him to be an artist. Let's give a warm welcome to Mike Andrews.
So thanks, Mara, for inviting me to participate and to speak with all of you. I'm going to walk you through my work from the past couple of years in an effort to speak to different styles of output that I choose, the physical, digital, and metaphorical possibilities of weaving. And these are qualities that I see in the production and the reception of woven artwork. I use weaving as an object, a metaphor, and a tool. And sometimes that means woven cloth, sometimes that means video, and often that means a range of other materials. For this lecture, because I'll be jumping through various media and styles of output, I didn't think it was appropriate to go through my work in a linear order. Rather, I landed on a collection of categories for sensibilities and strategies. One of the modes that grounds my work is exploration via drawing. See, there's a robust drawing program here. Lots of people are very engaged in drawing. And these three quick drawings or illustrations or icons will operate as symbolic representations, avatars, or containers for the following three categories: the surgeon, the flirt, and that thing. Even though I'm attempting to fix qualities and behaviors of my own work, I realize and revel in the fact that the categories themselves are slippery, and eventually they'll dissolve and crossfade. And when they overlap, this deepens their complexity, and in fact, they begin to inform one another. One of the reasons I choose to teach in this department at the School of the Art Institute of Fiber and Material Studies is the commitment to process, exploration, and material inquiry. And the culture and the ethos of the department mirrors my own approach to my investigations in the studio. The surgeon, the flirt, and that thing are tools for understanding what I do. They are an attempt at categorization to shape intention and relationships. The title sounds like it could be the title of a fictitious horror movie, and that tone comes from my interest in pop culture, literature, science fiction, cartoon imagery, and synthetic materials, in addition to my interest in complex structures, industrial output, and tactility. Section one is the surgeon. And here's what the surgeon represents to me: order, design, prototyping, testing, historical lineage, skill, making, fixing, naming, categorizing, structure, collage aesthetics, caretaking, and possibly it's the qualities of a mad scientist. Possibly that scientist is maniacal. This is a weave structure. I don't know if any of you have explored weaving or have interests in weaving. And this is a structure for a 16 harness loom, which is the mechanism that you distribute the threads through. And in order for the physical cloth to function and actually work, it has to follow certain behavior and parameters in the physical world. It must rely on tools and structure in order to be produced. Looms, warps, wefts, heddles, all fixed physical things. Implementing structure and knowing how to use it is one of the things I show students how to do in my weaving classes, and something that I also do in my own studio. On the other end of the spectrum, This is an animated GIF of a typical process in the Jacquard digital studio. So there's another way you can weave, which is an analog weave. It's still physical, but I teach students how to do things like this, where you're isolating color and assigning separate weave structures in an effort to show the different values of a graphic. And then the student then takes, or the user or weaver or whoever, takes that structural file to the loom and physically weaves the cloth themselves. So in my own teaching and in my own studio, I'm doing both analog and digital outputs. And I think the tradition of teaching weaving in the studio that I teach is related to a history of Bauhaus style education and design, in which weaving is considered not only as a functional object, but also an image. I'm sure you're doing some color study things here. The Bauhaus legacy lives on. And I'd like to share a quote from Ty Smith's essay. Ty Smith is a critic and writer, and she wrote this essay called "The Limits of the Tactile and the Optical, Bauhaus Fabric in the Frame of Photography." And in this essay, she writes how visuality and tactility intertwine. I don't know if anyone saw the Mahali Naj show that was at the museum, so the Bauhaus artist who was working across disciplines is someone who I really admire and feel like there's a similar sensibility. And so Ty Smith says, in other words, the term of tactile and optical, as exhibited in this instance of photography, served as preconditions and precursors to each other. The overlapping of visual and tactile texture in the photographs in Bauhaus magazine point to the larger debate going on at the time about the relationship and interdependence of optical and tactile perception, end quote, which I feel is still a very relevant discussion in terms of art making. So not only were the Bauhaus weavers designing for industry, they were exploring how woven structures could also be speculative. Considering this Bauhaus sensibility of combining industrial applications with unique expressions led me to my own project in collaboration with industry. Last year, I was invited to work with this group called the Scott Group, which is a production facility of rugs and carpets, and it's in Grand Rapids, Michigan, which is maybe 3 hours from here. And just in a pretty nondescript industrial park in Grand Rapids, and this company produces all the rugs for all the Chanel stores around the world, all rugs for the Louis Vuitton stores and other luxury brands. They also produce, interestingly, they produce all the rugs for the Oval Office. And so every time there's a new president, the president can choose which way they want the crest. It's the eagle with the talons is grabbing either the laurel branch or the arrows. And the president can choose which way the eagle will face, either towards peace or towards war, which I thought was very curious. I toured the factory last year and was immediately taken by the processes and scope and potential of what I could do. And so what we're looking at right now is this book that I made to begin the design process. I don't identify as a designer. I like design sensibilities, but I mostly work with sculpture and drawing and kind of more fine art processes to try to find a language to use to communicate with a design house was a tricky thing. But I made this kind of collage-y book and handed this off to the designers and said, this is, because their prompt for me after I toured the facility was, give us an idea of shape and color and scale, which to me was super vague. So I made this book and said, here, well, we'll just take these as cues. So my original idea was that these black line drawings, I wanted those to be the shapes of the carpet. I wanted them to have negative space. And then the other collaged imagery would be ideas for the texture or color or different processes that I really knew nothing about. Once we got to this stage, I was able to, so this image right here is a sample that the designers made. And then I went through and isolated areas that I liked. So I made this little kind of stupid graph of qualities that I liked about the rugs. I didn't want a rectangle. I wanted weird cut-in edges. I wanted there to be negative space. And I wanted there to be a kind of compelling exploration of texture and color. And it was at this point when I figured out that we were starting to share a similar language, which was really great. We went through a library of hand-dyed wools and settled on three different techniques. a cut pile, a shag, which is like a big, you know, hairy kind of 70s version, and a Berber, which is more like a, you might have it on your porch or something. It's kind of like a thicker thing. And like I said, I didn't want them to be rectilinear. I wanted curvilinear and anywhere there was negative space, and I wanted that to be cut out. And I think this relates to this idea of the surgeon going, because this was regimented, controlled, and detail-oriented. The company sent me, they were able to figure out how much yarn each carpet was going to need, and so they would send me these tiny little bundles of color samples, and the colors were just slightly different, but I had to approve all the colors, which was a process I'm not very used to at all, that kind of extreme amount of detail. And as a studio artist, this attention to detail and caretaking was new to me, and the aesthetics and motivations of high-end luxury brands are different from the way that I was normally working. And here's some of the other color studies we did. And each of these had at least three different textures. This one had two. Here's a detail. So that's the shag. The black is the big shag. And then the stripes is this cut pile. And here they're in the studio where they were produced. We just laid them out. But it was really fun to continue a collage aesthetic, to lay them on top of one another, to kind of play with them as drawings or as collage elements, even after they came out of this really high-end process. And two of these went to an art fair in Miami. And then I'll be showing a bunch of these at the show in Chicago at Volume Gallery, which is now in Ukrainian Village. They moved to Ukrainian Village on Chicago Avenue. So if you want to see them in person, you'll have a chance to see them in June. While these objects rely on a highly structured industrial process in order to be pushed into existence, I want to zoom out and share my more metaphorical approach to textile making. On a continuum that shifts from geometric hard forms to gossamer translucent lightness, I like to imagine textiles as a kind of slime. Slime oozes and bounces in the middle ground between solid and liquid states. Like slime, a weaver's allegiance can be mutable and its behavior unpredictable. Like slime, textiles morph and contort, moving between identities and associations. And as their location, use value, and scale switches, textiles have the capacity to become both images and objects, materials and immaterial, functional and dysfunctional. Color, construction, and media also contribute to this mutability of form and meaning, thus giving textile construction a tremendous capacity for wonder on both the part of the weave of the maker and the viewer. So this brings me next to my next category, this idea of the flirt. And I'll begin this category by sharing a quote from a book called On Flirtation, Psychoanalytic Essays on the Uncommitted Life by Adam Phillips. In this book, Phillips presents the idea of flirtation as a strategy, an indeterminate mode, a productive space. In this particular section of the book, Adam shares a quote from another writer, Philip Larkin, who is reviewing poetry by Sylvia Plath. Quote, Philip writes that Sylvia Plath's book, Collected Poems, quote, enabled the reader to chart her long flirtation with instability in language, end quote. And he makes us wonder, as flirtation does, where the instability is and how she kept it up. And of course, what kind of praise, what kind of recommendation this is. What would it have been for her to not flirt with, quote, instability in language? What else might she have done with it? The word flirt in a text, like the performance itself, creates an atmosphere of uncertainty, disfiguring the difference between innocence and experience, intent and opportunity. Flirtation does not make a virtue of instability, but a pleasure. It eroticizes the contingency of our lives by turning doubt or ambiguity into suspense. It prevents waiting from becoming a useless passion. And while it was a complex quote, what I like about it is it talks about indeterminate space, changeability, and adaptability. And I also like this kind of play with kind of erotics at the same time. This is a detail from a show I did a number of years ago called Getting Different in Naked Woods, which is this is a detail of a large-scale textile. This also leads into a discussion about software. My approach to production software and apps is guided by my experience with color and materiality of yarn and other more physical media. I think digital color can be cold and distant, or it can be vibrant and pulsating. I often, when I'm drawing, kind of switch my Photoshop. I don't know if all you use software, I'm assuming a lot of you do, but I really love drawing in Photoshop, and when I do start drawing, I usually switch to this palette, which is the Pantone palette that you can switch in your color palette idea. And I like this because this is a specific regimented international color system, and there's lots of visual options. And it offers so many options in a beautifully organized container, and it makes it manageable to create a flow of color relationships. And for me, color is both visual information and a material. Certain color combinations make my mouth water, and I like to use color as a way to whet one's appetite. I experiment with materialized color to elicit a range of responses, giving form to conflicting and perhaps unresolvable combinations of palettes and codes. This drawing is a combination of things I draw on my iPad, things I draw on my phone, things I draw on Illustrator, and the files are often just switched around, kind of flirting with one another. This image pairs the Pantone palette with something that weavers use, which is called a weave blanket, which is a way that in industry you can determine what your industrially woven textile is going to look like. So it's basically a color sample. So you pick, and there's usually a structure assigned to those colors. So when you're designing something, you would use something like this and tell the mill that you want this color in this location and things like that. And you would separate your image to do the same thing. Color is consistent throughout my work, but here's some other ways in which I flirt with various categories of making. So this is an industrially woven painting, blanket, throw thing. And this is a hybrid of drawings from Illustrator, Photoshop, from apps on my phone and my iPad, and bringing them all together. Again, earlier I was talking about this kind of what the qualities of digital color, and I think using things that perhaps look like some kind of brush in Photoshop, but then when it's rendered in cloth, it gives it a kind of tactility and texture to it, which is maybe different and different from what you see on screen. It has more physicality, but maybe it still has a similar kind of seduction. I think in some ways this gives weight and heft and grip to an image that maybe had none. And each of these are about 40 inches by 60 inches. So this next image is how I make the really large tapestries. So while I'm really interested in digital things, a lot of things in my studio happen in a really gnarly, immediate, tactile way. So this is my studio, and so this would be called, in weaving terms, this would be called a tapestry loom. And you can see there's this vertical material called a warp, and then I have these little pictures. You can see I have these little digital outprints kind of pinned to the warp. It's like a weave by number. So I'll mark off certain areas of the textile, and then I know that I have to fill in certain areas. And the technique that I'm using, this is all yarn I buy at Michael's too. This is nothing special. This is just acrylic yarn. And I like acrylic yarn for lots of different reasons. It's immediacy, it's vibrancy. And then I use this Turkish technique called sumac that I'm almost like crocheting on the surface to make a really flat surface so you don't see those vertical lines anymore. So this was them in that same show I was talking about at where I use these billboard forms, and on the billboards, on the face of them were these large scale tapestries, and on the back of them were these monitors that had low res, kind of crunchy animations. Some of these had a kind of curve to them. This one is called Gentlemen to Your Battle Stations. It's about 20 feet long by 10 feet tall, and the support is a curved wall. And so also walking through this gallery was kind of interesting because you had to, Your shoulder would brush against the tapestries as you walked by. It was almost like meandering through this kind of crowded space. And each one had a monitor on the back and a tapestry on the front. So they're quoting billboards, monitors, this hybrid between image and object. This is the back of a tapestry with its animation. Another strategy that I use as a way to move through textiles and move through image making is work made by lots of hands. So these pieces on the back wall, better detail here, are some things I made, some things I wove on my loom in my studio, some things I wove on a jacquard loom, some materials I found, other things like the top area, it's like a rug hooking section, maybe some of you might be familiar with that. I outsourced that to somebody, I gave them a palette and an image, and they then constructed those. And I like posing the question of what happens when multiple makers touch and contribute to singular things. That big gnarly is a woven thing, knotted parts, jacquard woven. There's polar fleece in here. I like polar fleece for its kind of the opposite of the homespun. It's this really gnarly industrial fabric. And then I also had a series of pieces on the floor. I'll just scoot back here. These are, and I'll show images of them later, but as a kind of companion or as a kind of foil to what was on the wall, these were these digitally printed polar fleece blanket drawing things that were had 3D images, collages. So there's this relationship between the analog and the digital in the same space. I want to jump a little bit to another reference for thinking about textiles, another moment in which technology and textiles come together, not just to produce cloth, but to produce ideas. Here's an image of the queen at a celebration for her 90th birthday. And at her birthday party, she chose to wear a dress that's also the same color of a green screen, when I saw your amazing green screen room down the hall. And so people kind of took this as an opportunity to play with this. And so there's these online moments where people were using the queen as an opportunity to key in other kinds of animations, other kinds of videos, other kinds of events on top of her. I'm sharing this video not only as animation and a collective interpretation of a cultural moment, but also as a form of speculation about another form of textile. The queen is a certain form of hierarchy, tradition, and lineage. And I think she represents things that are physical, tactile, stable, and structured cloth. And it's also a history, tradition, and lineage. And so when her garment becomes unstable, unfixed, moving, amorphous, she becomes a stand-in for the potential mutability of image and textile, which was also talked about in the Ty Smith essay about Bauhaus photography's relationship to weaving. And as her garment constantly changes, she's shifting identities and embodying different proposals. Her garment becomes a machine for inquiry and speculation. It's pretty great. There's lots of these out there. This is just a little one, but some good timing happens every once in a while. This is a self-portrait I did at Brad. It's maybe Brad's here somewhere. But I did this with Brad in Michelle's gallery, The Suburban. They invited me to do something. And at the time, I was starting to think more about portraiture as a way to use my materials, but also use my body more explicitly in some of the work. And I've never really done this before, but it felt right at the moment, and especially in the world we live in. So this is a restaging of a photograph from a book by Gloria Vanderbilt, as she wrote in the 70s, and the book was about collage. So she was, I don't know if you all know about her, she was a kind of socialite, designer, had this really over-the-top aesthetic, and she wrote a whole book about it, about her, how she would collage her interiors, the collages she made, which are all really kind of great and over-the-top. So this was the book jacket. This was the back of her, of the book that she made, which I thought was amazing because, you know, her presence, this insanely oversized couch, and everything is in front of the collage that she actually made. So really, it's nothing really about the work she made. It's more about her, which I thought was hilarious. So I just restaged it. And so I used my, so I tried to take cues from the photograph itself and use things in my studio, some leftover tapestries, other objects from my studio, and then keyed in one of my digital collages in the back. If the video of the Queen of England is what was captured and taken as an opportunity to destabilize and propose, I see this self-portrait as employing similar strategies, using slightly different methods. I'm in my studio dressed as a mutated version of Gloria Vanderbilt, standing in front of one of my own drawings keyed in through a green screen. This is just a studio test that I've been working on, exploring textiles through the media of the tutorial video. So this is a kind of a work in progress, but trying to chart and graph, keying over textures and animations over something physical. So this is yet to be produced, but these are things I'm working on in my studio, trying to use the language of the tutorial video or of the meme in ways to make some kind of physical and digital expression of textile. This maybe brings us to this last category of the thing. And the thing is slippery material, it's immaterial, it has unknown potential, It's illogical, it's disruptive, and it's chaotic. I think that the restaging of the Vanderbilt portrait was a gateway for new works in which I use images of my own body as a layer within other digital materials. So this series of animation portrait things I called Weird War, and they started Weird Wars, and they primarily started as posts on social media. Again, it was an exploration of using apps and drawing and really immediate things to communicate. And I just started, the series just kind of started. It was a layering, but it always started with my own face. So I can kind of walk you through how I make these. So I usually start with an awkward picture of my own face, usually with some kind of distressed or annoyed or anxiety-ridden expression. And then I migrate the image through a series of applications in which pixels are stretched and distorted and thrown into new applications. Objects are applied and masking is used to erase, to layer, to combine. So take a photograph, put it through one thing, put it through another thing, and then produce. This is an app that I use that overlays three-dimensional shapes. So I like to make these where it's hard to know where the pixels and the skin start and begin. It becomes this really confusing space. And I think they're continuing that, what I did with the Vanderbilt project in restaging, the Vanderbilt project, but this is a nod to something more possibly representational or figurative. Last year, I also was invited to be part of an online exhibition. This is called the WAG Gallery, W-A-G, and the curator invites artists to take over an image of a gallery space. So there's no actual gallery space, but the artist can populate that gallery with whatever they want. And so I did this series of animated forms inside of these this fictitious gallery space. So it's, again, continuing this idea of speculation and proposal and wonder within a representation of a physical space. Last semester, I started a new class with my students called Material Simulations, and I'm kind of extending the things I'm thinking about in my own studio, but sharing this way of thinking and approach and attitude with my students. This is a quick animation of a Blender tutorial. Blenders, I don't know if any of you have used Blender, but it's a 3D rendering program, and it's free, which is why I'm showing my students how to use it. And there's lots of resources online. And so I showed my students how to drape cloth, make things look like fabric, but you're starting with a digital source. And so we're starting to think about the software as the loom and animation as mimicking behavior of fabric. And even though the video as the loom is not a new idea, it's definitely related to experiments in early analog video art. But with the advent of 3D visualizations, I think there's an opportunity to extend that discussion and maybe open up a dialogue a little bit. So to zoom out a little bit, I'm going to go back to this category of the thing. And I think material doesn't always have to abide by physics. And I think through recategorizing video and animation as looms, I'm inventing endless warps and infinite wefts using images, 3D modeling, and video sequences. And I'd like to be experimenting with switching from traditional tools to software, not to make cloth, but to mimic cloth or cloth-like behavior, draping, folding, slumping, covering, which are also the behaviors of amorphous, immutable, and unnameable forms. And I hope this is a new territory for people working within textiles and fibers using 3D software to talk about textiles is different than using 3D software to make textiles. So we're using the advent of digital technology to make cloth, to stitch, design, organize, and make images into structures and functional things. From the surgeon's perspective, the computer or the loom is the main tool to create the thing that the surgeon is trained for, which is fabric. But from the flirt's perspective, if the flirt operates the computer or the loom or the software, what happens? And then we begin to have a conversation about impossible textiles, illogical textiles, irreverent textiles. These are some of the images from the combines of collage and 3D objects I did for those polar fleece images that I showed you earlier. I'd like to show another excerpt from the Ty Smith essay on Bauhaus fabric, In this section, Smith is quoting renowned Bauhaus era weaver Odie Berger. And Odie said, "A textile is not only an optical object. We come into perpetual contact with it, so it is recognized through our tactile sense. A material, therefore, also has a grip," end quote. Despite her seeming matter-of-factness, her straight-to-the-point style, Berger employs a single word to designate multiple ideas. Griff, which is set in quotation marks, can be translated as handle, but also means something like the texture or friction of a cloth felt to the touch. And that evokes the ineffable tactile sensation of contact with the object. Moreover, by calling attention to this griff, Berger acknowledges the precarious role of tactile sense perception insofar as this contact is perpetual and without definite temporal boundaries. And this brings to mind what Berger wrote in her essay, Fabrics in Space. "One must, quote, one must grasp the structure not only with one's brain, but also feel it out with subconscious." I love that quote. It's kind of have a juicy, that's the space I want my work to be in, where this idea where you're, it's this desire and the space between something physical and something visual. I want to maybe end here with these two videos. The top video is from a How It's Made video of how polar fleece is made. So this is a factory that is rendering plastic into tiny bits, shaving it down through this 3D animation, and then it's eventually spitting it out through tendril-like forms that are then formed into polar fleece. And the bottom video is from an animation TV Adult Swim cartoon called Rick and Morty, which I'm sure many of you have seen. And this is a factory scene called How to Make a Plumbus. So this is how a plumbus is made. In the animation, you're never told what a plumbus does or what it is or what it's used for, but you're told how it's made. And I think that that's a great way to think about sculpture. I think I'll stop there. Thank you. We can talk about the work. We can talk about going from community college into other phases of your creative life. I'm happy to talk about anything. Oxbow, whatever you want to talk about. Yes?
So when you have your textiles in exhibitions, do you prefer them to be viewer interactive or seen from a distance?
Well, the question was about how, when I show my work, do I want them to be interactive or do I want them to be seen from a distance? I think it depends on the venue. Some venues I get the opportunity to make really big work, and to me that I would like to have both experiences where you can have it, where you have to have a really compressed experience with it, but you can also stand back in the gallery and have a bigger view. The images from the Devonine show was a really tiny space, so you couldn't get that full picture. I think my background is also is in sculpture, and so a lot of my decisions when I hang shows are about how you move through the space, and so it is both kind of the image of it and, you know, getting the full picture, but also what it feels like to move through that space. That combination is really important to me, and sometimes that can happen on a bigger scale, and sometimes that has to happen in another way. So I think both, to answer your question. Yes, the answer is yes. Any questions? Yeah.
Do you get a lot of influence by Adult Swim by any chance? Because if you're ever up at 4 or 5 a.m. off the air episodes, mm-hmm. you're familiar with those?
Some of them, yeah. Yeah, what was that one? The Heart She Holler, did you watch that one? That was really bizarre.
I feel like I'm in a dream when I'm awake.
Yeah, I think that those. I think about this all the time. I love the stage, by the way. I feel like I'm on Pee-wee's Playhouse right now, which is really great. And that was also a big influence to my life, too. But I think if I can't even imagine, I think about this all the time. If I was a kid watching those crazy shows, like what would, like I'm really excited to see what art is going to be made in the next 10 years after people like you who are staying up watching these totally insane, non-linear, but beautiful, beautifully colored and graphic and odd. I mean, the logic and the kind of wonder that are associated with those, I think is so exciting and bizarre. So I love all that stuff. Yeah.
I'm curious, the new work that you've done, the rugs, the mm-hmm. different shapes, how do you display those? Are those displayed on the floor, on the wall?
Well, I've only had one show with them so far. I showed two of them at with Volume Gallery at one of the art fairs in Miami, and they showed a really big one. It was on the wall. We just didn't want a lot of people traipsing on it, thousands of people at the art fairs, to get it ruined. So I'm still deciding that. I mean, one of the reasons I love textiles is because they can switch. They can be on the floor, they can be on the wall. You could wear it. I mean, it has this kind of mutable, changeable, irreverent. I mean, you can switch it all the time. I have a couple pieces that I didn't really show here, but I don't really tell people how to hang them. So I'll send them off to shows, and sometimes they'll go on the floor, or sometimes they'll be draped in some weird architectural space in the gallery. So I like that they're mutable, and I think with these rugs, I mean, what I like about them is you could actually, you know, live with it. It's a really high-end, pretty nice rug that you could live with, but it also could be hung as a painting. Or I like that in-between area for sure. So come to the show in June, you'll see what I decide on. Yeah?
Do you sell your works at all for us?
I'm working on it. Why, are you interested? Do you have a... Okay. Come talk to me afterwards. I mean, I've sold the tapestries and I've sold a lot of drawings, and it's been really exciting to see where these new ones will go, because they are, I mean, they are an actual functional rug and something that you could live with. So I'm excited about the possibility of finding the person who would want to live with these. I think is just as exciting as kind of making them. Yeah.
Out of your three categories, which one seems to have the most positive feedback?
Can you elaborate?
Yeah, like you said, the surgeon sort of thing. Like when you're creating things with those categories in mind, which category seems to get the most positive feedback from people?
I mean, so the question was about the categories and which one is the most positive, most positive feedback. I think I use those categories I think as artists, it's really hard to talk about the direction of your work and how you move and what your timeline is. And I think it's, to me, it was really silly to think that it goes in a nice ascending order, you know, based on, you know, the things that you make, the things you're interested. I feel like my thinking and my interests are kind of more like networks kind of going out and coming back in. So that kind of linear shape didn't really do a service to me. So I landed at these three categories because I think these are qualities that I think my work has and things that I have. And I don't think any one is more positive or advantageous than the other. I think they all kind of work with each other and cancel each other out and support each other. So I don't know if you've done exercises in your classes here where you kind of try and define how you make your own work, and to me this was a tool to try to do that. And you know, even as I said earlier, you know, the things I make and the categories that I'm making, sometimes they illustrate it and sometimes they undermine it, but I think that's great. I think in some works they look like the rugs look more, they have a certain kind of production value, so they have that would maybe be the more organized category, but then some of the other, either like the speculative ideas or the drawings, are more quick and fast, and so they maybe are more these other categories. Yeah, to me it was just as a tool to kind of help get you into my mode of thinking. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. Okay.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. So you initially mentioned that you focused on sculpture first. What made you interested in textiles? How did you get inspired to work?
I think, well, I can back up a little bit. The question was about starting with sculpture versus textiles. But I think when I was in a place like this, I was doing animation and stop motion animation and video and editing and things like that. So I think my trajectory, if we want to talk on a consistent timeline, went from like animation and video to sculpture. And then at some point I realized the sculptures that I really wanted to be making always had this relationship between images and objects. And then to me, the textile was the perfect hybrid of all those things. So it's both those things at the same time. So that took me a long time to land there. I wasn't really planning on doing that. When I was a kid, people in my family were always making kind of sewing things and crafting projects, but I liked that sensibility, but I was never really doing that kind of stuff. But now I'm very enmeshed in it. So, I mean, just curious, and you know, I'm sure you'll find in your path that you'll if you're open to it, you can allow your ideas to change. And if you follow what your ideas are and you follow what you're seduced by and what you want to pursue and what you want to know more of, it follows. But the more you keep doing it, the more it kind of folds back into your original ideas or your original motivations. Or it's kind of strange. Just so even though I started making animations, you know, when I was in my early 20s and like a teenager, now I'm back and using these programs again. So it's curious how these things, if you pay attention to them and take care of them, they kind of keep folding in on themselves in a productive way. Yeah.
Well, first of all, Adult Swim, too many cooks has taken up too much of my life. But anyway, I just want to know, how did you come up with the names for your three categories, like the surgeon, the flirt, and the thing? You start out with drugs. How do you get to surgery and Fantastic Four?
These are great questions. So the question was, how do I come up with the categories and how do I relate them to what I'm working? Again, this is like a tool for a venue like this to talk to get people, you know, I have like 45 minutes to get you into how I think about making and looking at the world. So to me, the work that I make and I think who I am as a person is on the spectrum between control and chaos. And so I think that finding things that, and maybe we all feel like that, but I think that having these categories that describe that, so on one end of the spectrum being very methodical and organized and researched, and then making space for something that's uncontrollable and possibly dangerous and chaotic and crazy, and having those within that spectrum, and then maybe the flirt is the thing that goes back and forth between those categories. So I'm not quite sure what point I landed on those three, but I was searching for words that were open, that talked about control, but also talked about chaos, also talked about the unnameable, maybe the strange, maybe the seductive. So those terms for me just seemed like the right way to put a frame around something, but not exactly commit to all these things, because it's all those things that I think build up what I do and kind of who I am. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.